Hello everybody, Alex here. Welcome to my Finance and Accounting Education channel. Today we are going to have another company presentation. I'm invested in this company just as a disclaimer. And also I'm not a financial analyst, so sharing or buying any financial instruments related to this company, being it shares or bonds and so on and so forth, based on these videos is not recommended. If you decide to do so, I take absolutely no responsibility in your decision making. We have been speaking already about another real estate investment trust, because we are going to speak about a real estate investment trust right now. This week we have been speaking about the German round town, linking the video right now. Let's just say that I have chosen to enter in the real estate investment trusts last year as an alternative to investing in property, buying property objects like buying houses or apartments, because from my point of view, investing in real estate investment trusts has several advantages. One being diversification, because you are not investing only in one apartment or in one house. You are investing in a company which owns a diversified portfolio, which sometimes spans around geographically over several cities or even countries. Sometimes it's also expands in, let's say, in terms of sectors. You can have rates which are present in commercial, in residential, in hotels, in offices, and so on and so forth. Right now I'm linking the video about the first video of a 5 video series about real estate investment trust. In this 5 video series I have analyzed the real estate investment trust included in Stock 600. Stock 600 is the, let's just say, the brother of S&P 500, but from Europe. So the 600 largest and most significant European companies listed on stock exchanges. And I have evaluated all the real estate investment trusts. So I went sector oriented in 3 countries. So basically 3 of the largest countries in Europe, namely United Kingdom, Germany, and France. And the company which I'm going to present to you today is called Derwent. Was one of the, of course, because I have invested already in it, was one of the winners of my evaluation and got one of the highest scorings, of course. But before we are talking about Derwent, I'm just going to clarify. I have said also last week that somehow my investment strategy or my thinking has switched or shifted to somehow trying to play the inflation, which is affecting all of us. The video about inflation is linked right now if you want to find out more about inflation. And the idea was that you can have more or less 2 strategies. One is to go to companies which have strong brands or are in such sectors that can easily pass the inflation to the customers. I have presented to you Unilever as an example, the fast-moving consumer goods company which has so such strong brands that the price increases will lead to very reduced volume drops, which is not affecting as a result the top line. Why? Because the customers are so attached to these brands that they just won't give up on them that easily. If we are talking about sectors, would be like the real estate, in which making changes or somehow adjusting your consumption behavior is very difficult, because you need to live in one house or in one apartment, and as a result the real estate sector can pass very easily the inflationary pressure further to the tenants, let's say, being them companies or individuals and so on and so forth. And the second way to play inflation from my point of view is to go into the resources, because they are the sector that is actually generating, so they are the starting of the chain of inflation generators, the resources companies, the mining ones, the ones in oil and gas and so on and so forth. And because there is where the money is fleeing right now in these sectors, and of course as investors we want to go where the money goes. It's as simple as that. But before we jump right in and we talk about Derwent, I'm going to ask you to subscribe to my channel, to hit the bell notification button. It doesn't cost you anything and it will help me a lot. If you do this, you will never miss an update on my site. I do them quite regularly. You should expect new and hopefully interesting videos from me on Tuesdays, Thursdays and Sundays as well. That being said, we go directly in. So we have Derwent London. We've seen already the results of Unilever. Unfortunately, or fortunately, I don't know how to take it exactly. Unlike the requirements for the companies listed on New York Stock Exchange or Nasdaq in the United States, the companies in France and also the ones in United Kingdom, we've seen it when we talked about rates like Jichin and Covivio from France. We've seen it when we talked about fast-moving consumer goods Unilever. They are not required to present at the end of the quarter, at least not at the end of the quarter one. I hope that they will present some fully fledged financial statements during the earnings calls for at least for the half of the year. But they are presenting some flavor of the top line. So Unilever was looking at the sales. You will see that Derwent is also looking at the occupancy, so you know, this kind of top line numbers which are driving the revenues. But it's okay, in absence of any other information, it's better to just do this or to get some sort of information in this form. So we have a 5 pages release, first quarter business update, well positioned in continuing flight to quality, Derwent London. Summary, so portfolio update, letting spaces above ERV. ERV is the estimated rental value, which means the value that they should get from rent based on the market conditions. They have £3.9 million of new leases achieved year to date, 8.2% above December 2021 ERV. In addition, £3.3 million of space is under offer at rents above ERV as well, including 28,000 square feet at the Featherstone building, EC1, 125,000 square feet in total probably, which reach practical completion in April. So it's quite a, let's say, a recent building. 3.1 EPRA, we talked about EPRA as well, is the European Public Real Estate Association, which is somehow issuing some guidances about these KPIs. So 3.1% vacancy rate at Q1 2022, full year 2021 1.6%, with current vacancy at 6.4%, in line with our expectations and principally reflecting Featherstone completion. So basically their occupancy went down because they have completed the new building. Yeah. Investment activity, adding C1 million square foot to the development pipeline, conditional exchange of contracts for the £239 million acquisition of City Rhode Island EC1, the site of Moorfields XI Hospital in the Tech Belt, adding a potential 750,000 square foot generating supersite. See separate announcement for further details. Complete the purchase of 230 Blackfriars Road to SE1 future super site for £58.3 million, currently ending £2.1 million per year. Major developments on track, delivering net zero carbon schemes. Soho Place W1 achieved practical completion in February. Occupier fit out of the fully pre-let offices has commenced. Adjacent 2 and 4 Soho Place is expected to complete in Q2 2022, so we might get into even lower occupancy rate if they are completing the buildings faster than they can manage to rent them, which is also not a very good thing. But let's just see. Commitment to network building, W1, 137,000 square feet of offices, start on site June 2022, so at the end of Q2. Financial position, strong balance sheet, loan to value 23.2% at Q1 2022. This is great. We've seen this week around town they are at 40%, so let's say that Derwent is far better position, that they have less debt than around town. Cash and undrawn facilities of 441 million at Q1 2022. LTV based on 31st December 2021 property values and including a group share of joint ventures. London is busy, so Paul Williams, chief executive of Derwent London, said London is busy again and maintains its global appeal in an uncertain macro environment. The flight to quality continues. Our portfolio is well positioned and we are seeing a high level of inquiries and viewings. As a result, we have committed to our next major office development at Network Building. Then you have the portfolio update. We talk more or less about the details which are presented here. Capital recycling, appendix 3. We have exchange conditional contracts for the acquisition of City Road Island DC1 for a base price of 239 million before costs. This 2.5-acre freehold site is located in the heart of the Tech Belt and an area where we have substantial holdings and have undertaken several regeneration schemes over many years. Our early reappraisal showed that site has potential to deliver a major 750,000 square feet campus with generous public realm and strong environmental credentials. The existing buildings total see 400,000 square feet. See separate announcements for further details. We completed in January the acquisition of 230 Blackfriars Road for 58.3 million including costs. This 60,300 square feet building with an income of 2.1 million per year has potential for 200,000 plus square feet scheme. This super site adds to our long-term development pipeline. Development progress, see appendix 4. Good progress has been made this year to our near-term developments including the Featherstone building as noted above. In February, Soho Place 1 reached practical completion and a new head lease from TfL was subsequently granted for 71.9 million. Leases on the offices which were 100% pre-let to Apollo and G Research have now completed and the 336,000 square feet of retail was launched last week. We are confident in the prospects for this space, which we expect to benefit from the forthcoming opening of the Elizabeth Line. 2 and 4 Soho Place 1 is due to reach practical completion imminently. Then at Network Building 1, our latest net zero carbon development, we have committed to develop the office-led scheme. The work is due to commence in June 2022. 19 to 35 Baker Street, 298 1,000 square feet, an uplift of 108%, commenced on October 2021 with demolition works due to complete shortly. As previously reported, we have signed the building contract and 97% of capex of the office element, 8% of the overall scheme is fixed and in line with budget, thereby reducing our exposure to further build cost inflation. So I think there were like two questions from the analysts. One was how they comment about the construction materials inflation, and of course the answer was, well, we are in a sector which can pass the inflation very easily to the tenants, just as I have said, so thus confirming my evaluation what I already knew about real estate. Finance, after capex of 36.8 million and acquisition of the Soho Place head lease and 230 Blackfriars Road, net debt increased to 1.4 billion at 31st of March 2022 from 1.3 billion at 31st December 2021. As of 31st of March 2022, the LTV ratio, loan-to-value ratio was 23.2%, including the group share of joint ventures up from 20.8%. Interest cover for the first 3 months of 2022 was 4.1 times. If we remember, Derwent had a 5.7 times, so they are covered. Just a short reminder what the interest cover is the, let's say, how many or how large is the earning, are the earnings before interest and tax compared with the interest expenses. So basically you are paying the interest expenses from these earnings before interest and tax. Very interesting. I don't know if it's the case also for Derwent, but for Aroundtown they were not using earnings before interest and tax. They were actually using EBITDA, so earnings before interest and tax, depreciation and amortization, which is of course a little bit higher than EBIT or PBIT. So yeah, it's a different approach. Full year 2021 4.6 times. And cache and undrawn facilities totaled 441 million at the quarter end. Then we have Appendix 1, leasing activity 2022 year to date. So we have area in square foot let 55,500 in Q1, Q2 to date. So actually they are giving you us, because the results were presented on 5th of May, they are also giving you 1 month of results in Q2. H1 2022 to date 64,700 square feet. Income 3.5 million per annum, 0.4 from Q2. In total 3.9 million. Performance against December 2021, ERV, open market 6.8%. So ERV, we said, is this estimated rental value. From open market they should have got 6.8 in what they rented in Q1, and 20 million what they rented in Q2. H1 up to date, so H1 2022 to date 8.2 million. I think here must be an error. I think it's 6.8 and 2 million, probably, most likely, to reach the. And overall 6.8 and 20. Yeah, this is. I don't understand this. But let's just move further. Maybe I will have an idea what they want to say with these numbers here, because they somehow don't add up. Here, if you add 3.5 with 0.5, you get to 3.9, which is logical, the income. Here 6.8 to 8.2, you are missing a 1.4 actually, not 20. And to be honest, from 9,200 square feet, you cannot get more than from 55,000. 500 square feet. But let's just see the appendix two principal lettings in 2022 year to date. So there are some addresses from London, mostly, I think. Michael Kors, Brain Labs, Digital Net, River Raid, Talon Outdoor, and Q2 to date. So this Blackfriars Road, which was just completed, Wendell Housing Association. You have the square feet here. The rent in pounds per square foot, so you see from 72 to 49.50, total annual rent 1.4 million, 0.8, so 800,000, 300,000, 300,000, 400,000, adding up to 3.2 million. You have some additional information here, some others, probably smaller and more objects which they didn't want to detail as such. Lease term 10 years, 6 years, 5, and 7.5 years. Lease break year, only one has the, actually two have this after 3.5 years and 4 years. And rent free equivalent months, 24 rent months, 10.4, 11, 6, 7 plus 6 if no break. Major acquisition and disposals in 2022 year to date. Acquisitions: Blackfriars Road and Soho Place. Headless, we spoke already about them. And disposals: New River Yard EC1, which was exchanged, they say. Major developments in pipeline: we have the Featherstone Building EC1. 125 square feet, 1,000 square feet, capex to complete 10 million, comment 110,000 square feet in offices, 13,000 square feet in workspaces. Workspaces, what's the difference between offices and workspaces? I have no idea. 2,000 square feet retail, 22% under offer. On site projects: Soho Place, Francis House, Baker Street, so it's everything is in London. Proposed area 285,000 square feet, 38,298. I mean, it's just interesting to see that they have projects. It's very hard to say if it's enough, it's too much, it's too less. I'm no specialist in real estate. Then 2022 projects are, so they have also projects for plan for 2022. New network building and bush house, they didn't start them, I think. Network building was due in June 2022. And then we have notes to editors. Derwent London PSC owns 77 buildings in a commercial real estate portfolio predominantly in central London, valued at 5.7 billion as of 31 December 2021, making it the largest London-focused real estate investment trust. Our experienced team has a long track record of creating value through the property cycle by regenerating our buildings via development or refurbishment, effective asset, so they are flipping the properties, effective asset management and capital recycling. We typically acquire central London properties off market with low capital values and modest rents in improving locations, most of which are either in the West End or the Tech Belt. We capitalized on the unique qualities of each of our properties, taking a fresh approach to the regeneration of every building with a focus on anticipating tenant requirements and an emphasis on design. Reflecting and supporting our long-term success, the business has a strong balance sheet with modest leverage, a robust income stream, and flexible financing. As part of our commitment to lead the industry and mitigate climate change, Derwent London has committed to becoming a net zero carbon business by 2030, publishing its pathway to achieving this goal in July 2020. In 2019, the group became the first UK REIT to sign a revolving credit facility with a green franchise, with a green tranche. At the same time, we also launched the Green Finance Framework and signed the Better Buildings Partnership Climate Change Commitment. The group is a member of the RE Real Estate 100, which recognizes Derwent London as an influential company committed to 100% renewable power by purchasing renewable energy, a key step in becoming a net zero carbon business. Derwent London is one of the only few property companies worldwide to have science-based carbon targets validated by the Science Based Targets Initiative, SBTi. Landmark buildings in our 5.6 million square feet portfolio include 80 Charlotte Street, Brunel Building, White Collar Factory, Angel Building, Stephen Street 1-2, Horse Ferry House, and T Building. In January 2022, we were proud to announce that we have achieved the National Equality Standard, the UK's highest benchmark for equality, diversity, and inclusions. In April 2022, Derwent London. So this is mostly all the this information about this are disclosures about ESG, so environment, social, and governance. Derwent London won the BCO Best Commercial Workplace Award for 80 Charlotte Street. In October 2021, the group won EG's UK Company of the Year Award, and in January 2022 came top of the property sector and 38th position overall in Management Today's Britain's Most Admired Companies Awards 2021. In 2020, the group won several awards for Brunel Building, with the most prominent being the BCO Best Commercial Workplace Award. In 2019, the group won EG Offices Company of the Year, the CoStar West. It sounds like they are bragging, but I understand that they are disclosing some such information. In 2013, the company launched a voluntary community fund and has to date supported well over 100 community projects in the West End and the Tech Belt. The company is a public limited company which is listed on the London Stock Exchange and incorporated and domiciled in the UK. So, which we already know because I said that I'm an investor, so it's nothing new. That was it about Derwent London. As you have seen, there are absolutely no financial statements. There are only general statements about occupancy, about development, about new buildings, what projects are they starting, what have they sold, what have they acquired in terms of property, how is it looking compared with this estimated, I always forget this, EVR, estimated rental value, this ERV, actually not EVR, estimated real rental value. Let's hope that for the H1 2022, so somewhere in summer, August, September, we will have fully fledged results for this company, for at least for the first 6 months, and then we can talk about the P&L and the balance sheet and the cash flow and all these details that, let's just say, are the bread and butter of the financial analysis of what the company is actually doing in terms of. I mean, we have here the LTV also. the loan to value, but it's based on the value at the end of 2021, so it's not really updated, but still interesting information as well in this presentation. Thank you for your time. If you like this video, hit the like button, comment in the comment section if you have something to add on the topic, share it with somebody that might be interested about this topic, so real estate investment trust, specifically Derwent of London. But most importantly, do not forget to subscribe to my channel and to hit the bell notification button. It doesn't cost you a thing. If you do that, you will never miss an update. On my side, I do them quite regularly. These days, on Tuesdays, Thursdays and Sundays as well, you should expect new and hopefully interesting videos from me. Below this video you have links. You can create an eToro account and trade there without a commission or a fee. Shares, cryptocurrencies, although I don't recommend cryptocurrencies in general, and not paying a commission or a fee is always a saving, no matter how often you are trading, once per day or once per year. Be careful, however, what you are buying, because some titles or some companies are available as both as the shares themselves or as CFDs. Some are available only as CFDs. One important example would be Aramco, Saudi Arabia, so the largest oil company in the world, gas and oil company in the world. And if you are trading leveraged, you are only going to get CFDs there. And below that link there is another one with the Amazon wishlist with hardware and software items which can help me improve the quality of my videos. That's being beneficial for you because you will get, of course, better videos from me. But let's just be honest and say that from financial perspective, that is the most inconvenient for you. The easiest way to support me remains subscribing to my channel. It doesn't cost you a thing and it will help me a lot. Hitting the bell notification button and, of course, continuing to watch my videos. Once again, my name is Alex Petrescu. This is my Finance and Accounting Education channel. I hope you enjoyed today's video, and I look forward to presenting to you with the next opportunity. Goodbye!